presents this unabridged recording of
The Remains of an Altar, written by Phil Rickman, read by Emma Powell. Part 1. The Bible record is unmistakable in its references to the old straight track as having partly or wholly gone out of use. The ancient high places are in possession of the enemy. My people have forgotten me. They stumble in their ways from the ancient paths. Alfred Watkins, The Old Straight Track, 1925. Chapter 1. On the Bald Hill. More than a day later, there was still wreckage around. A twisted door panel across the ditch and slivers of tire like shed snake skin in the grass. It had rained last night and the Rev S.D. Spicer's cassock was hemmed with wet mud. What might have been a piece of someone's blood-stiffened sleeve was snagged in brambles coiling like rolls of barbed wire from the hedge. The countryside, violated, wasn't letting go. It felt to Merrily as if the air was still vibrating.
"Other vehicle was an ancient Land Rover Defender," Spicer said. "Must have been like driving into a cliff face."
Ground mist was draped like muslin over the hedges and down the bank, and the early sun lit the windows of a turreted house in the valley. Looking back along the road, Merrily could see no obvious blind spots, no overhanging trees.
"Boy died in the ambulance."
Spicer nodded at the metallic red door panel, crumpled and creased like thrown-away chocolate paper.
"Took the fire brigade best part of an hour getting him out of the car. Fortunately, he was unconscious the whole time."
Merrily shook her head slowly, the way you did when there was nothing to be said. No act of violence as sudden and savage, massive and unstoppable as a head-on car crash. She was thinking, inevitably, of Jane and Arian out at night in Arian's small car. One momentary lapse of attention, a snatched caress, and...
"He was in his mid-twenties. Lincoln Cookman from North Worcester. The girl? No hurry to get her out. She'd had her window wide open. No seatbelt. Head almost taken off on impact. Sonia Maloney from Droitwich."
"Oh, God." Merrily took a step back. "How old?"
"About 19.
Spicer's London accent was as flat as a rubber mat.
"All horribly brutal and unsightly, but mercifully quick. No suffering. Except, of course, for Preston Devereux."
"Sorry, Preston?"
"Local farmer and chairman of the parish council and, as it happened, the driver of the Land Rover. Returning late from a family wedding."
"Oh, hell, really?"
"Could have been any of us, Mrs. Watkins. Parish council's been asking for speed cameras since last autumn. Not that that would have made a difference, state these kids must have been in. They come over from Worcester, places like that, at the weekends. Windows open, music blasting, 65, 70, wrong side of the road. Poor guy's still reliving it. He'll need a bit of support. My job, I think."
"And what's mine exactly, Mr. Spicer?" It was a reasonable question, but he didn't answer. Parish priests would often have difficulty explaining why they'd resorted to deliverance. Spicer had been terse and cagey on the phone yesterday.
"Can you come early, before 8 a.m, in civvies? Best not make a carnival out of it."
"Okay." Just gone 7:50 on a Monday morning, and here she was in discreet civvies, jeans and a sweatshirt. And here's the rector, all kitted out. Cassock, collar, pectoral cross. Merrily felt wrong-footed. Why would he want that? She'd never met him before, didn't even know his first name. Never been to this village before, out on the eastern rim of the diocese, where it rose into the ramparts of Worcestershire.
"Well, the point is," Spicer said, "this is the worst, but it's not exactly the first."
"You mean it's an accident black spot?" Sometimes when a stretch of road acquired a reputation for accidents, Someone would suggest that a bad pattern had been established, and you'd be asked to bless it. One of those increasingly commonplace roadside rituals, support for all the roadkill wreaths laid out by bereaved relatives. How did all that start? Anyway, it was a job for the local guy, unless there were complications. How many actual accidents have there been, Mr. Spicer? He didn't respond. He was standing quite still, shortish and thick-set, with sparse, greying hair shaved tight to his head and small, blank eyes that seemed to be on his face rather than embedded there. Like a teddy bear's eyes, Merrily thought. Poor man, Sophie had said last night on the phone. She took the children, of course. It was as though some part of Spicer had withdrawn, the way a computer relaxed into its screensaver. Not many people could do this in the presence of a stranger, especially clergy who, unless they were in a church, tended to treat silence like a vacuum into which doubt and unbelief might enter if it wasn't filled with chatter, however inane. Okay, whatever. Merrily let the silence hang and looked up at the tiered ramparts of the sculpted fortress hill called Herefordshire Beacon, also known as British Camp. This was the most prominent landmark in the Malverns, where the Celts were said to have held out against the Romans. The misty sun was hovering over it like a white-cowled lamp. The name Malvern came from the Welsh Mull Bryn, meaning bald hill, and bald it still was, up on the tops of this startling volcanic ridge, while the foothills and the alpine-looking valleys were lush with orchards and the gardens of summer villas, well-preserved remains of Elgar's England. 3, 4 now, Spicer said. Maybe even 5, including this one. That's inside a couple of months. One was a lorry, took a chunk out of the church wall. And on a stretch of road as open as this, I suppose that's... Drivers reckon they swerved to avoid a ghost, Spicer said. His tone hadn't altered, and his eyes remained limpid. A wood pigeon's hollow call was funneled out of the valley. That took a while to come out, didn't it? Merrily said. Come back to the house. He turned away. We'll talk about it there. Chapter 2. Uncle Alfie. After very little sleep, Jane awoke all sweating and confused. On one level, she was lit up with excitement. On another, fired by the wrongness of things. Injustice, greed, sacrilege. Bastards. The thinness of the light showed that it was still early, but the Mondrian walls were already aglow. Ancient timber-framed squares, once wattle and daub, then plastered and whitewashed, and finally overpainted by Jane herself, in defiant reds and blues and oranges. It was more than 2 years since she'd coloured the squares. Just a kid then, disorientated by the move to this antiquated village, with a mother who used to be normal and had suddenly turned into a bloody priest. Just a kid, determined to make her mark. Jane's here now. Jane takes no shit. This is Jane's apartment. This is the way Jane does things, okay? In a 17th century vicarage, it wouldn't have been at all okay with the listed building's police. But it had seemed unlikely that they'd ever come beating on the door with a warrant to investigate the attic. Looking back, Mum had been seriously good about it, letting Jane establish a personal suite up here and splatter the walls with coloured paint they couldn't really afford, and never once suggesting that it might look just a bit crap. But that was over 2 years ago, and now Jane was... Christ. 17. And this once important gesture, these once deeply symbolic walls, were looking entirely, irredeemably... naff. Not even much like a Mondrian. In the middle of an art A-level course, she could say that with some certainty. More like a sodding nursery school. Decision. the Mondrian walls would have to go. You were in no position to fight senseless public vandalism if you couldn't identify your own small crimes. That sorted, Jane sat up in bed and looked out of the window at the real issue. Full of the breathless excitement of new discovery and a low, burning rage, which, she'd have to admit, was also a serious turn-on. Below her, beyond the front hedge, lay Ledwardine. This black and white oak-framed village, embellished with old gold by the early sun. Defended against neon and advertising hoardings by the same guys who would have freaked if they'd ever been exposed to the Mondrian walls, while totally missing the big picture. The focus of which was just beyond the village. A green wooded pyramid rising out of a flimsy loincloth of mist. Coal Hill. She'd always assumed that it had simply been named after somebody called Coal who tried to farm it a few centuries ago. Now, Coal Hill. It sang with glamour. Jane sank back into the pillows, last night's images coalescing around her. The slipping sun and the line across the meadow. Drifting down from the hill with the blackening steeple of Ledwardine Church marking the way like the gnomon on the sundial of the village. Amazing. Inspirational. But like, for how long? Tumbling out of bed, she dislodged from the table the paperback, old straight track, she'd been reading until about 2 a.m. Photo on the back of benign-looking bearded old guy, glasses on his nose. Alfred Watkins of Hereford. County councillor, magistrate, businessman, antiquarian, photographer, inventor, all-round solid citizen, and visionary. Jane Watkins picked up the book. You and me, Uncle. This book, well, it had been around the vicarage as long as Jane had, and she'd thought she must have read it ages ago. Only realising a week or so back that all she'd done was leaf through it, looking at Watkins' pioneering photos, assuming his ideas were long outdated, his findings revised by more enlightened thinking. Now, because of this A-level project, she'd finally read it cover to cover. Twice. Feeling the heat of a blazing inspiration. And it was all so close. Mum was probably right when she said that there was no family link. And yet it was as if this long-dead guy with the same name was communicating with Jane along one of his own mysterious straight lines, saying, help me. Jane turned her back on the clashing imperatives of the Mondrian walls, stumbled to the bathroom and ran the shower. She needed backup on this one. 2 years ago, telling Mum would have been a total no-no. The issue too left field and the gulf between them too wide. 2 years ago, the sight of Mum kneeling to pray would have Jane shriveling up inside with embarrassment and resentment. But now she was older, and Mum was also more balanced, a lot less rigid. Except for the rumble of the old arga and the rhythmic sandpaper sound of Ethel washing her paws on the rug in front of it, the kitchen was silent. Jane found a note on the table. It said, Jay, you've probably forgotten all about this, but had to leave early this morning to meet paranoid rector in the Malverns. Thick sliced loaf in bread bin, eggs in basket. Don't forget to leave dried food out for Ethel. Sorry about this, Flower. See you after school. Love, M. Flower, like she was 7. But yeah, she had forgotten. In fact, there'd been so much on her mind when she'd come in last night from Coal Hill that she'd hardly listened to anything Mum had said before pleading fatigue and bounding up to the apartment to research well into the early hours until she'd finally fallen asleep. Jane left the note on the table, went to find the dried cat food for Ethel and grab a handful of biscuits from the tin.
No time. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.